In this episode of the Ruth Institute Podcast, we tune in to Dr. Mark Rollo's wonderful interview with Dr. Jennifer Roback Morse on his show, First Do No Harm. You will hear these two engaging speakers discuss her book, The Sexual State, How Elite Ideologies Are Destroying Lives and Why the Church Was Right All Along. Dr. Morse tells Dr. Rollo of how she transitioned from a seemingly tranquil life as an economics teacher at Yale to a defender of the family and founder of the Ruth Institute. She tells of the adoption of her son from a Romanian orphanage and the birth of her daughter, which led to her having two children in less than 6 months. This abrupt change in life taught her many things, but most importantly, that children need their parents. Dr. Morse expounds on three of Ruth Institute's core values near and dear to all of us who work with her. Firstly, that all people have the right to know their cultural heritage and genetic identity. Secondly, that every child has a right to a relationship with his or her natural mother and father, except for an unavoidable tragedy. And thirdly, that we reject the idea that a child is a problem to solve if you don't want one, and an object to purchase if you do want one. She explains that these are natural principles that arise from simply considering the perspective of the child in society, as opposed to the adult's needs and wants. Continue listening to hear the facts.
Hello and welcome back to First Do No Harm, a show about medical ethics from a Catholic perspective. I'm Dr. Mark Rollo. I will be focusing on a brilliant book by Dr. Jennifer Roback Morse, who is the founder of the Ruth Institute, a nonprofit organization founded to expose and address the lies created by the sexual revolution over the last 50 years. The title of her most recent book, which we will be discussing, is The Sexual State, How Elite Ideologies Are Destroying Lives and Why the Church Was Right All Along. That is a mouthful. The book can be found on the website ruthinstitute.org. The name Ruth means grace, and the Ruth Institute and the book we will be discussing is a grace to all of us. I think everyone listening to this podcast should have a copy of this book, which can be purchased on her website. It is a roadmap to saving society. Joining me now is Dr. Jennifer Roback Morse. Welcome to this podcast, Dr. Morse.
Well, thank you so much for having me on. I really appreciate the invitation.
Yeah, well, it's very exciting to be able to speak with you. I find we have a lot in common. I think we're both baby boomers. We're both Catholic. We both have families. Both of us are, fortunately, survivors of the sexual revolution of the 60s. And when I saw the title of the book, I said, I got to read that book. And when I was reading through it, I found myself saying, yeah, that's right. Yeah, yeah. Yes, I agree.
Well, that's a good sign when a reader right. feels that way about your book.
Yeah, because you really articulated some of my own kind of amorphous impressions about the culture.
Yes.
But before we actually start talking about the book, I wanted to ask you how you went from being an economics professor at Yale and George Mason University to founding the Ruth Institute, which you described as an interfaith international coalition to defend the family and build a civilization of love. How did that transformation occur?
Well, the short answer is children.
Yeah.
That's the short answer. We adopted a little boy in 1991 who had been for 2.5 years in a Romanian orphanage.
Mm.
And then 6 months later, we gave birth to our baby girl. And so we had two children 6 months apart who were 3 years apart in chronological age. And what that did for us, my husband and I, I'm an economics professor, my husband's an engineer. You know, we're kind of nerdy people, you
yeah.
know, nothing prepared us for what we were about to deal with.
Yeah.
Let's put it that way, right?
Mm-hmm.
We were so not prepared. But what it did was to show us, we basically had a controlled experiment in our household, and we basically saw, wow, kids really do need their parents.
Yeah.
This is what happens when you don't have parents, you know, and our boy, it's sad, but true that all of the kids that came out of the Eastern European orphanages at the time, they all had the same set of problems, Mark.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they all had speech delays. They all had social delays. Some of them had occupational therapy needs. You know, they had tactile sensitivity. They had a whole variety of problems that, of course, I didn't know anything about as an economics professor.
Yeah, I had to
get a short, real quick course. But what it taught us is that kids really need their parents. And because of my social science training, I start looking around me and thinking, you know what, if kids really need their parents, this society is really set up all wrong.
We've
got things going that are creating incentives for people to do all the wrong things
mm-hmm.
that are not going to help kids whatsoever. And, of course, in economics, incentives is what we study, basically.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
That's kind of all we got.
Yeah, right.
You know, when you get right down to it. And so I started, as the kids got older and the kind of hands-on parenting became a little less intense, I started thinking about that in a systematic way and started writing about it. And the book you mentioned, Love and Economics, that was the first book that I ever wrote. And it was really a book about motherhood
mm-hmm.
and why kids need their mommies and why mommies need the backup of a daddy, you know,
because what
you're doing there, with the bonding and the attachment that takes place between a mother and child is so significant. Not just for that child, but for the whole society, because if it doesn't get done, if mom doesn't do it, the substitutes are really, really bad.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I mean, that's just a fact there, you know. I mean, adoptive mother is a great substitute for biological mother,
right.
But it way goes downhill fast after that.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
So that's what got me interested in the topic. And by 2008, the kids were getting older. You know, they were finishing high school and whatnot, and I'm thinking about my next move. And basically decided that the best thing to do would be to start my own organization focused on what I thought was important to focus on, you know, rather than try to go back and find another academic job or something like that. That probably wasn't going to happen for
mm-hmm.
a lot of reasons. So that's how I started the Ruth Institute. You know, I just saw a need for an organization that would focus specifically on the role of marriage and family in creating a stable environment for children and why that's so important. So that's pretty much how it happened.
Yeah. Well, so your full-time professional job became children, your children, and how the culture affects them.
Yes. I did take time off. You know, this was another aspect of my life that I did take time out of the labor force to stay home with my kids, and I had a part-time job at Hoover Institution at Stanford.
Mm-hmm.
And that was a whole kind of dramatic thing too, because I was trying, like anything, to do a full-time job in part-time hours.
Yeah.
You know, when the kids arrived, I had a tenured position at George Mason. And everybody thinks, oh, academic life is so flexible, it's great, it's easy. But there was nothing easy about it.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
My plan had been to put the kids in daycare. Well, you can't put a orphan into daycare, you know? I mean, I tried, which was, you know, it was crazy, but I soon learned that my plan was not going to work. So I had jumped ship out of academic life and, you know, walked away from a tenured position, which, as you probably know, no sane person ever does, right?
Mm-hmm.
So my commitment then was to work part-time. And I went to the Hoover Institution when we moved out to Silicon Valley. My husband moved us out to Silicon Valley. And I said to the director of the Hoover Institute, I said, you know, I need to be a quarter time. That's really all I can manage.
Mm-hmm.
And he said, this is the easiest job interview I've ever done.
Yeah.
Boom, I will take you as on part-time basis. And he came up with a salary for me that was a quarter of what he thought I was worth full-time. And it was wonderful. I mean, I'm extremely grateful to John Razian and the Hoover Institution mm-hmm. for the flexibility that they showed to me.
So instead of kind of farming out the kids to daycare, you sort of farmed out part of your family life. And that kind of, you know, comes through when I was looking at your website, the ruthinstitute.org. And right off the top, you made some very strong statements about children and families, and I'd like to read three of them and get you to comment on those.
All right.
So the three that hit me as soon as I opened the webpage was, all people have the right to know their cultural heritage and genetic identity. The second one was, every child has a right to a relationship with his or her
natural mother and father, except for an unavoidable tragedy. And the third, we reject the idea that a child is a problem. And this is what I heard all the time and in my medical practice and all of the fallout that occurred with families. We reject the idea that a child is a problem to solve if you don't want one, and an object to be purchased if you do want one. Those are three very insightful statements. I wonder if you could expand on those.
Well, I'm a radical on the position that kids need their parents.
Yeah.
And, I mean, I just, and you know, Mark, I can make these strong statements because, doggone it, I know I'm right. I know I'm right. And I don't care what anybody says. I mean, the truth is, are you going to sit here and tell me kids don't need their parents?
Yeah.
Well, what is this? You know, or that they don't care whether it's their biological parent or adoptive parents? Adopted kids care a lot, you know, and adoption's the best case scenario in many respects. I mean, not in all respects, obviously. But we have all these permutations of family disruption, you know, of disrupting the relationship between the parent and child.
Mm-hmm.
The thing about adoption is that adoption is something that we do to help the child have the parents that he or she needs. And it's a backup plan when things go wrong. Many of the other things we're doing are basically things that allow the adults to do whatever they feel like with the assumption that the kids will be fine. The kids are resilient. They'll be fine. They'll get over it.
Right.
You know, and it's simply not true. And
yeah.
So we at some point made the decision. That's a whole story how we figured that out, how we figured it all out. But but we at the Ruth Institute, we approach everything from the perspective of the child.
Mm-hmm.
And when you do that, when you say to yourself, okay, what is owed to the child? What is owed to children? You come to realize very quickly that that is a radically countercultural statement.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
And you come to see that so many of the things that we're doing really are simply about adult comfort and convenience. And we're assuming that the adults are snowflakes and will melt at the slightest provocation,
mm-hmm.
while the children are so resilient that they'll be fine.
Yeah.
And so if you start with the position that children are entitled to a relationship with their parents unless something unavoidable happens, right?
Mm-hmm.
If you start with that assumption and then start reasoning back from that, you know, you take that as your starting position and then reason outward from that, where you end up, Mark, is with traditional Christian sexual morality.
Mm-hmm.
That's where you end up, because you find that to preserve the child's right to the parents, you need to have a commitment on board that you're only going to have sex with the person you're married to, and you're not going to have sex before, after, or during marriage with anybody other than the person you're married to, you know?
Well,
and it's 100% logical, perfectly logical to think that way.
I was thinking as you talk, Jennifer, you must get into a lot of trouble saying things like that.
Oh, sure, but I don't care.
Yeah, I know. When I was, before I went to medical school, I was in social work school, and so I was around a bunch of liberal people, and they would say things like, I can't think that the only reason to have children are selfish reasons. And I was thinking, what are you talking about? You know, because you want children to fulfill your own needs, you know?
Wow.
And so I would hear things like that. And then hear things like, if you're having trouble in your marriage, staying together for the children is not a good reason to stay together. When in fact, it's the best reason to stay together.
It actually is. Yes. And in fact, the social science disproves that, by the way.
Mm-hmm.
You know, in other words, if you examine the data, how do children fare after divorce? You know, you find out very quickly that divorce is very difficult on children. And in fact, Mark, there is no serious dispute about that within the social science literature, okay?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
You can read that stuff till your eyes go blind, and you will find that divorce is hard on children, that the married couple, intact biological family, is the gold standard for children's outcomes, on any outcome that you want to measure. And including, people have even studied, well, what about if there's conflict in the marriage? Well, if there's high conflict, if people are throwing pots and pans and beating each other and stuff, okay, maybe.
Mm-hmm.
You know, maybe the kids do better. if the parents divorce. But in general, the vast majority of divorces do not involve that.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and what no fault divorce did, and this, as you know, you read the book, The Sexual State.
Mm-hmm.
When the state redefined marriage from being a lifelong, permanent, sexually exclusive union to being something else,
yeah.
which no-fault divorce did, and turned it into something else, the main thing that was affected was the low-conflict marriage,
mm-hmm.
right? That was enshrining the idea that you don't have to stick it out for the sake of the kids.
Yep.
That was the law coming down on that, because what people forget is that you could always get a divorce for cause, even under the darkest, most benighted medieval days of the Eisenhower administration.
Right.
You could get divorced for cause. You know?
Yeah.
There are a lot of myths out there, and we spend a certain amount of our time busting the myths, which, mm-hmm. you know, which is really a kind of propaganda that's out there supporting the sexual revolution. That's turns out to be a big part of the work of the Ruth Institute, is to deal with that stuff.
Yeah, I remember in my state, in Massachusetts, it was Governor Mike Dukakis, who eventually ran for president, who brought no-fault divorce to our state.
Uh-huh.
And at the time, it seemed like, isn't this an enlightened thing to do, when it just turned out to be a disaster.
Yes, yes. You know, one of the people who, in a way, is a kind of tragic heroine, is a person named Judith Wallerstein, because she was a psychologist, psychiatrist, I forget exactly.
Mm-hmm.
But she, you know, she believed in no-fault divorce. She thought it was a great thing,
yeah.
you know, and she pioneered it and so on. And I one time met people in San Francisco whose marriages had broken up because she had told them that this was a fine thing to do and it would be all good. But she then turned around and started studying the children. And she literally had a 25-year project where she was tracking the children of divorce. And she found out within the first 10 years that, hey, guess what? They don't just get over it the day after yesterday,
yeah.
you know, the very next day. They do not get over it. And in fact, the problems get worse in some respects as they get older, in the sense that not that the kids fall apart or get worse or whatever, but the problems that... When you go to form your own relationships, when you go to form your own marriages and you're embarking on all that, the way Judith Wallerstein put it is that the problems crescendo in young adulthood.
Yeah,
they don't go away.
No,
they don't.
They
go
absolutely
away.
Don't.
People know this, Mark. People know this, but they will not say it. You know, it drives me crazy.
This concludes part one of my interview with Dr. Jennifer Roback Morse.
You've been listening on the Ruth Institute podcast to Dr. Jennifer Roback Morse being interviewed by Dr. Mark Rollo. We hope you enjoyed this episode. The Ruth Institute is a global interfaith coalition equipping Christians to defend the family and build a civilization of love. Founded by world-renowned author, speaker, and academic Dr. Jennifer Roback Morse, the Ruth Institute provides decades of research to support individuals and families harmed by divorce, the hookup culture, and other forms of family breakdown. Our podcast can be found online at ruthinstitute.org/podcasts. If you've enjoyed them, please share them with your friends, like us on Facebook, and subscribe to our weekly newsletter to stay informed.